Members, we have a technical problem. I now call the meeting to order. Just before we get started, ROP 83A and 84. 83A has to do with the disclosure of pecuniary interest, and 84 refers to the voting arrangement regarding members who have a conflict of interest. I don't have any interest to declare. Do I hear any declaration of interest? Mr. Lam Chek Ting, Chairman, I don't have any pecuniary interest, but I am the person who lodged a complaint with the ICAC. I don't think you need to make a declaration. Everybody knows what you did. Okay, then, unless there are any further declarations, let's move on to the first item, CB2904/16-17(1). Members must have received the paper, and in fact, we have already taken note of the recommendations regarding the terms of reference. And basically, the terms of reference reflects the substance of the petition presented by Mr. Andrew Wan and Mr. Kenneth Leung on the 2nd of November 2016. And our terms of reference is set out in paragraph 4. So have a look at the paper and see whether you are prepared to confirm the terms of reference. All right, then. Item 2, proposed practice and procedure of the Select Committee, paper number 02. We did have similar Select Committees before, and this practice and procedure are based on the previous model. We have made suitable arrangement because we don't enjoy any powers and privileges under the ordinance. Mr. Holden Chow, Chairman, thank you. I'd like to put a question here. Para 8 refers to voting. Should voting take place? If the votes are equally divided, the chairman will have a casting vote, which shall not be exercised in such a way as to produce a majority vote in favor of the question put. I don't think I understand this. If there is a tie, effectively it means that there would negative the motion. So the chairman will be voting against the motion, indeed, right, just for clarification. Right? Unless members have any questions, let's confirm the proposed practice and procedure. We can make revisions as we see fit as we go along. All right, let's move on to item 3, proposed major areas of study. And this is put together in the light of the terms of reference. This is to facilitate the Select Committee and the Secretariat to make arrangement for the witnesses to be invited. I'm grateful to the Research Division for putting together a brief and information note on our UGL incident. If members have any questions, I can invite the Research Division to take members' questions. Members Holden Chow. Chairman, thank you. I've got a comment to make for discussion, perhaps. The Secretariat has put together the proposed major areas of study, which are in sufficient detail. Now, the terms of reference has been endorsed earlier on by members. There are basically 3 points to the terms of reference. So my view is, shouldn't we just follow the 3 points in the terms of reference? Now, in the major areas of study, there are many items, minute items there. I am afraid that we may venture out of the scope of the TOR, and this may be controversial. I think the simplest way to proceed would be for us to follow the 3 points in the TOR. I don't have to read them out. As long as we follow the 3 points in the TOR, it would be simpler as we proceed with this select committee. This is just for members' discussion. Well, we have the main trunk, and we were fleshing out the key points in the major areas of study. Mr. Kenneth Leung, please, Chairman. In the appendix, proposed major areas of work, and that already answers Mr. Holden Chow's questions. Roman letters 1, 2, 3, and 4. 1 is about the background. 2, 3, and 4 are actually on the basis of the 3 main points, and these are an extension of the 3 main points. I don't think I am too much worried about venturing out of the scope. 2A to D are the guidelines binding us, if you agree with me, Chairman. Mr. Lam Chak Ting, I'm really grateful to the Secretariat for putting together these major areas of study. Basically, they are on the basis of the terms of reference. If Mr. Holden Chow feels that these have gone beyond the scope of our terms of reference, I hope that Mr. Chow would specifically pinpoint the items that he considered to be exceeding the scope of the TOR. I think it would be good for us to proceed in a more organized manner that would be far more effective. I don't think we should just interpret the terms of reference too literally, because that in itself would be controversial. Mr. Holden Chow. Ms. Andrew Wan. Also, I'd like to thank the Secretariat for the efforts. I agree with the Chairman that this is in great detail. Now, in paper 03, appendix 2, there is a paper from UGL, and there's an agreement between the UGL and Mr. CY Leung, and there is only one signature at the bottom right hand corner on page 22. Now, there is a sentence inserted to that under additional commitments. Once again, I don't see any signature, any initial by both parties, only just the one initial there. And is this the true copy that we have? I think we can confirm the documents at a certain stage. The Secretary has got the document. Now, this handwritten inserted sentence, in fact, we have added a recommendation, 3C. Now, the Secretary has been treading carefully, and they have put forward an item in this regard. As to how the document should be handled, we can take this at a later stage. Any comments for the first round? Mr. Junius Ho, Chairman. By way of procedure, have we formally adopted paper 01? regarding the terms of reference. So this has been formally adopted, haven't we? Yes, the preparatory committee has made a proposal, and this committee has adopted this. Of course, going forward, there is still room for further improvement. Otherwise, we have already adopted the terms of reference. Chairman, if we are going to adopt this proposed area of study, do we have to have the endorsement of the Health Committee? Now, our power is derived from this. I think there is enough incubation. We can take decision as we see fit. The proposed major areas of study is one of the decisions that we have to make. We don't have to go back to the House for an endorsement. Is my understanding correct? Secretary, please. Mr. Ho, if we refer to paper 904, bracket 03, in paragraph 2, we have made it clear that the proposed major areas of study reflect the substance of the petition, and we follow the Preparatory Committee's recommendation, and this is a context provided to members to proceed with the inquiry. And this is a context provided for members to proceed with the inquiry. And this is only there to facilitate a member's work. And members are free to revise this in the light of the TOR, Mr. Ho. So we can add to that, we can take things away from it, can we? Yes, of course. But the addition or subtraction have to be within the scope, Mr. Ho. So for the terms of reference, the terms of reference has been adopted, and on top of the terms of reference, we're going to be adding or subtracting from the scope. It will be controversial. We have the terms of reference there, and in this lay committee, can we change the House rules to make it convenient for the select committee? No, Mr. Ho, I think the four walls are there. It's just that these are the guiding tool for our work, and they're not binding. You can revise them, you can take things away from them, you can add to them. It's just that within these four walls, we can put questions in these four areas, and we can invite the witnesses and prepare all the documentation. The members are welcome to put forward any suggestions to revise the proposed major areas. But the four walls can't be taken down. Well, there are only three walls there, basically, one, two, and three. I think we have to tread carefully here. The documents have to be very handled very seriously. We have the preparatory committee. I thought that we're just following the terms of reference. Now, if we add one additional word, it may give rise to different interpretation. This is very broad. Roman 1, we have the three sub-paragraphs. I think we can add the 10 paragraphs there, as long as they're within the parameter. I don't really want to have any arguments here. I think we have to follow the terms of reference. Now I have to refer to the terms of reference, and I don't think any assistance regarding the minute details, because worried that we may be acting out a virus and this would put us in an embarrassing situation.
The legal advisor has raised his hand. Maybe he has a comment. Thank you, Chair. Maybe I can add. Mr. Ho and other members have shown concern towards this issue. The operation of this select committee is such that when we embark on our work, we'll still be confined by the TOR. As the clerk was saying, the proposed major areas of study have been drawn up following previous select committees. This is really to assist the operation of the select committee, and these are just proposed major areas of study. As the chairman said, when the select committee is in operation, we have always to follow the TOR. When the SC embarks on its work, if members feel that the proposed major areas of study may venture outside the TOR, well, they can so decide and not continue with that line of investigation. I think Mr. Ho, the legal advisor, has taken care of your concern. This is really a working tool, and you can always add to it or subtract from it. Maybe members would like to ask questions in a certain direction, and you may want to know something in a certain area. So these are just for mapping out the directions. Mr. Lam Chek Ting, Miss Priscilla Leung should have her first round. Thank you, Chairman. We do understand that we have got the TOR for the Select Committee, but I don't really agree that we can always add to or subtract from these papers. Well, I don't think anyone would have a big issue with subtracting from the areas of study, but I have been in other select committees, and if you want to add to the investigation, sorry, Ms. Leung, are you talking about the major areas of study or the TOR? No, this is particularly important for new members to select committees. It is not that you can always add to the areas of study. Let us really discuss the proposed major areas of study with a lot of care at this stage. If you want to follow the proposal of the clerk or secretariat, we should go through all the points one by one, and we should ask the secretariat to explain why some of the issues have been threshed out in much more detail, so we can have a focused discussion. My own experience is, if you say you can add to the areas of study, well, I don't think that should be allowed as members like it. No, even if you want to make any additions, they should be within the TOR. Right, you should not be able to make additions as much as you like. I don't think that should be the case. Mr. Junius Ho asked his question. Should we just go for the TOR, or should we go through the proposed major areas of study point by point now? I, myself, would like to ask the secretariat to explain why the proposed areas of study have been formulated as they are on the basis of the TOR. Okay, we can have a detailed discussion of the major areas of study in a moment. Mr. Kenneth Leung, first round. About this appendix, I agree with you, Chairman. The scope has been defined, and these are just the details. But I would agree with Ms. Priscilla Leung that we should not casually add to the major areas of study. Maybe we can embark on our work according to the proposals, and if there is a glitch anywhere, we can take care of that as it arises. Mr. Chairman, I have been working on the PAC together with you for 5 years, and the TOR of the PAC is just a short paragraph. And Mr. Chairman, I depend on your able leadership. Let's move on. Before we make a decision, let's listen to other members. Mr. Lam Chek Ting. Chairman, I'm a rookie here. I'd like to please ask the secretariat to guide me on this. Is it that usually the secretariat would formulate proposed major areas of study for select committees, and also usually this is done apart from having the TOR? In the past, in-house committee meetings, pro-establishment members have always said that we should respect the conventions of the council. We wanted to have a bigger committee, and then they said it should just be confined to 11. That's the convention of the council and should be followed, they said. So has it been like this before, that we have the proposed major areas of study for select committees? Is it that this was one of the essential elements of previous select committees? The clerk, please. Well, that's correct. The secretariat would usually draft some major areas of study for the select committee to consider and whether to follow such areas of study. So that has been for every select committee set up in the past. That's correct. Mr. Holden Chow, your third round. Chairman, well, this is how I understand it. Say if we are going to go through the proposed major of areas of study, I would be raising queries on many of these details. But at present, I'd like to say that following on from Mr. Junior's Ho's view, and this may be the view of other members as well, we have the TOR, and I understand the Secretariat is trying to facilitate our work, so they have threshed out the details. But frankly, these can give rise to controversies. And I am really saying we should avoid causing controversies and we should just follow the TOR. This is what I want to say, and I just want to keep things simple. That is all I want to say. Mr. Elvin Young, first round. Chairman, whether it's Mr. Holden Chow or Mr. Junius Ho, why are they saying there are these minute details? I don't get it. We have spent so much time on the proposed major areas of study. These are words we all understand. What do they mean by minute details, and why they think anything has ventured outside the TOR? I think that would be more constructive, and that would facilitate the conduct of this meeting. Okay, if members have no other views at present, let us try to narrow our differences. Let us now go through the proposed major areas of study and let us see whether there is any problem with any paragraph. Okay? Let us now go through the appendix. Proposed major areas of study, Roman 1. The agreement itself, there are the sub-items A, B, and C. Mr. Holden Chow, Ms. Priscilla Leung, if you have views about the drafting of these points, maybe you should raise them now. I think other members don't have much to say about the proposed areas of study. Ms. Priscilla Leung, well, we should be very careful with the proposed major areas of study. We usually do that with any select committee. Was it Mr. Andrew Wen? Oh, one of you, anyway. About the agreement, the handwritten line provided that. I remember that was from Mr. Andrew Wen. Actually, all the signatures are the same. Either we accept this agreement as one of our documents. No, this is already in the information note. So the signature is the same. I don't see why, therefore, C says whether Mr. Leung had provided any service or assistance as per the terms of the agreement. Unless you say this document is not admissible because there is only one signature, we can talk about that when we take evidence later. But on the face of it, there has been a revision to the agreement. I think it should not be mentioned like this. We should cross out something here. It says here, as per the terms. Well, I think the most important point is whether any service or assistance has been provided. Well, as for the agreement itself, we have to dig into it later, but should we depend on this agreement and whether it has been amended? That is actually not the major point of concern, but I'm all ears to members' comments. If you put everything here, And then later on, people might argue why we have emitted this paper because there is only one signature. Should this be the agreement we use? I think Mr. Andrew Wen made a legitimate point. Well, sure, when we come to the stage of taking evidence, we will look at the agreements, which agreement, whether there is a signature and whether there has been any amendment or revision, etc. Mr. Lam Chek-Ting, Chairman, to respond to Ms. Priscilla Leung, C is that after he had become the chief executive, whether Mr. Leung had provided any service or assistance to UGL as per the terms of the UGL agreement. This is extremely important because Mr. CY Leung said many times in public that he had not provided any service to UGL and UGL did not demand that he provided any assistance. And also in the agreement, there is this proviso about the avoidance of conflict of interest, and Mr. Leung is interpreting this to say that this does not constitute any conflict of interest. In our TOR, Roman 2, whether the UGL agreement had given rise to any conflict of interest on the part of Mr. Leung as the chief executive. So 1C here asks whether Mr. Leung had provided any service or assistance. I think this is most pertinent. This is an important point in our TOR as well. Thank you, Chair. Mr. Legal Advisor, is it that you would like to respond to Ms. Priscilla Leung? Yes, Chairman. I'd like to clarify one point, please. The agreement within the information note, well, at this stage, this is not a document for the Select Committee as such. This is to provide background information for reference by members. This is information collected by our research division. If I understand it correctly, this document is actually available on the Internet. And at the next meeting, the Select Committee will have to think about the taking of evidence and which witnesses to call. And also, when the operation of the committee is in session, whether agreements or documents have to be requested from any parties, that can be decided by members. But at this stage, this document is not a proper kind of document or any kind of evidence for the Select Committee. Mr. Holden Chow, thank you, Chairman. My view is, I'd like to look at this from another angle. If we write it to say whether Mr. Leung had provided any service or assistance to UGL as per the terms of the UGL agreement, well, I understand what other members were saying, and that is we want to know whether he had provided any service or assistance to UGL. But if you say as per the terms of the UGL agreement, then, well, I have read the entire agreement. And as far as I can see, this is because after the transaction, this is to make sure that there will be no competition. If we write it to say as per the terms of the UGL agreement, then it seems we are assuming that when the agreement was signed, this was to confirm that service or assistance would be provided. I think as it is written, this may give rise to misunderstanding by the public. I think to be fair, we should just say whether any service or assistance had been provided, instead of having this tagged to the line as per the terms of the UGL agreement, because if you write it like this, it seems to say that the signatory was going to provide any service or assistance. Now, this is how I see it. I don't know what other members think. I hope you understand that this is not an affidavit or anything, so you don't have to haggle over the wording so carefully, but I understand what you are saying. You don't want to have that qualification there. Mr. Alvin Young, Chairman, I believe members here are not giving evidence here. We have our own political stance, of course, but on the basis of the background information provided by the Secretariat, and then we come up with stance, I don't think this should be done by anyone who is up to his job. And moreover, 1C says whether Mr. Leung had provided any service or assistance to UGL as per the terms of the UGL agreement. And on the face of it, it is asking whether the service as included in the agreement has been provided. This is a simple kind of logic. Of course, this is my view only. Mr. Kenneth Leung, I have nothing to say, Chair. Mr. Lam Chek-Ting, Chairman, like to provide some information to Mr. Holden Chow.
22版,
page 22 in the additional commitment.
Motion of the UGL group and the DTZ group, and as UGL may reasonably require, including but not limited to acting as a referee and advisor from time to time. Okay?
This is made very clear to promote UGL as a group. Now, this is to the committee, the select committee, to inquire into matters about the agreement between CY Leung and UGL. So we're asking whether he has fulfilled what is required in the agreement. What's wrong with that, Mr. Chow? I don't think we should be arguing back and forth. Chairman, I'm just responding to Mr. Chow. Now, we're not being acrimonious here. We're trying to be cooperative. Like Mr. Kenneth Leung said, we're trying to be fair and impartial in order to get to the bottom of the facts. And we don't have to come to any conclusion about legal liabilities. It's not what we're here for. Legal advisor just reminded me that what Mr. Chow said is a double-edged sword, because if you do away with the terms of the UGL agreement, you're just asking whether he has provided any service or assistance to UGL, then it would be very, very broad. It would make it even more difficult for to handle. If you don't draw in reference to the agreement itself, then we make it very, very broad, and maybe just one phone call will result in him doing certain things. Mr. Wong Kwok Kin, first time. Yes, my turn. Right, I think I'm suffering from a bit of bird flu. I sound very croaky. Right, this is how I feel. The members have already made a lot of comments. There are a couple of members who refer to the agreement not being a formally adopted document. If we work on the basis of this document, which has not been formally adopted, and say that providing service as per the terms of the UGL agreement, then I think we are having some preconceived ideas. We're not challenging the legal advisor or the secretariat. I just feel that the way we phrase it here, we should have some basis for what we do. This agreement is not with us yet. I'm wondering whether we can rephrase it somehow. Or it's just like a vehicle. The vehicle is here. It's a question of not having the wheels. Nobody disputed that there is such an agreement. If we have to wait until after we have started before we confirm the agreement, it would not be a good idea. Nobody ever disputed that there is such an agreement. When we take evidence, it's a question of which agreement should we base on, and all the details. And unless we're saying that there is no agreement to speak of, I don't think we have to divorce ourselves from the UGL agreement. Otherwise, we'll have to be reinventing the wheel. Chairman, you have made comments on behalf of the Secretariat. My view is that if the legal advisor is correct about a box being made bigger, now the question is whether he has provided the service to UGL. Well, I don't think we should be talking about these out of the context of UGL. Perhaps I defer to the Secretariat or the Legal Advisor. I don't want to put words into their mouth. Legal Advisor, please. Well, let me say something first. The Secretary might wish to supplement. I must state that proposed major areas of work study are to facilitate members' work. We don't have any preconceived ideas. At the preparatory committee, the TOR has been prepared, and this is on the basis of that. Second, for 1C in the proposed major areas of work, to address Mr. Holden Chow's concern, what I was trying to point out is that if we do not mention the UGL agreement in 1C, then it would give rise to a situation mentioned by the chairman, and that is we don't have a context. We can talk about any service or any assistance to UGL without the context of the agreement. If members would like to revise it, then it's a member's prerogative. Also, Chairman, the scope, the context is here. If we look at the TOR, in the first sentence, we refer to the agreement entered into in 2011. So the basis is here. It's a question of how we phrase it in the proposed major areas of work. If members have any comments, they're free to raise them for revision. It seems that we are debating on many things, but I think we are actively participating in the discussion. Ms. Eunice Yong, Chairman, point number one. Background, nature, and details of the agreement between Mr. Leung and UGL. Now, regarding the conflict of interest, now here on the first point, it is the major terms and conditions of the UGL agreement, B, the amount and nature of payments, and major Mr. Leung. I think we can add B and C on the next page here. I think we should explain the nature and the effectiveness of the agreement. I don't think we should talk about C here when Mr. Leung had provided any service or assistance to UGL. We should not put this under background because this is covered in E, whether Mr. Leung provided any service or assistance to UGL during his term of office as CE, which had given rise to any actual or potential conflict of interest. So C, 1C can be taken out, and 3, B and C can be added here. Well, the context is the UGL agreement. Basically, we're talking about this agreement. I don't have any strong views moving them around, but I think it is logical the way it is drafted here. I'll let you hear from members. Mr. Junius Ho, please. Chairman, precisely this is my concern. We have the terms of reference, which is sufficiently clear, and why all of a sudden we have these proposed major areas of work. The TOR is TOR. You can compare the two to ascertain whether there are any conflicts. I think we have to be stringent in our work. We have the TOR, the scope here. I think we can do without the proposed major areas of work when we proceed. We're basically considering 3 points. Whether Mr. Leung had contravened BL 47 in terms of declaration and all the money shy, I don't think we need to dwell on those here. We haven't even read the agreement. And we have to start looking at 1C, and this is a preconceived idea, and I don't think it is necessary because it would be causing trouble for the future. I think we should proceed according to the procedure. Whatever the TOR says, we proceed accordingly. Previously, we had 9 or 7 select committees before. Now, you may say that we did have these proposed major areas of study. Should we observe the convention? If everyone is happy, then it's fine. But I think we smell some controversies here. And at the previous meetings, we spent so much time discussing the TOR. And without any prior warning, we have the major areas of study, which are more in more detail than the TOR itself. You may say that this is not binding on us, but for the record, I won't even look at these proposed areas. I'll just stick with the TOR. Well, you might brush it aside, but the Secretariat would have all these questions in mind. We're just organizing them into a paper for members' reference. This is not binding at all on members. Mr. Oh, you are a lawyer yourself, and you may have more questions in your mind, 10 times more questions in your mind than what are written down here. But I mean, this is just to group them all together to facilitate members. If you have strong views about these, you can just brush them aside, but the Secretary has to do something to facilitate our work, and you can present 100 questions to them, Mr. Ho. I do think it's right for us to give direction to the jury until we have heard the entire case. Now, we're not jury here, of course. We have the TOR, which is the starting point, which is the yardstick for us. We'll look at the UGL agreement, and this is something for the committee to consider. I think we can brush aside this appendix here. I don't think it is necessary for us to go into minute detail about this appendix. Well, I don't think I should speak too much and make people think that I do have any position. I don't. And I don't think we should talk about us in terms of a jury. It's just that when the Secretariat decides on the documentation to be sought, the witnesses, they're just preparing this. And Dr. Priscilla Leung suggested that we go through the appendix one by one to see whether there should be any addition or any subtraction. Mr. Ho, I think you are suggesting that we do away with this altogether. We would create something out of a vacuum. Well, it's not what I suggested. I think that we are being led by the appendix. We have to follow the TOR. Well, you are a really distinguished lawyer. You may be able to come up with something. Ms. Andrew Wen, once again, I must heap praise on the Secretariat. I believe that you would follow similar logic even for university student or my daughter in secondary school. They would follow similar logic. You have the background and all the rest of it. I think this appendix is pretty logical. I don't understand members' concerns. There may be some wordings that are rather touchy, but all these questions are real questions. Maybe they haven't done anything like what is suggested here. Then the truth will be out. I think this is a question of logic. 1C. If you take out as per the terms of the UGL agreement, it would be very weird. It would be out of focus. Now, the agreement is there. The person concerned accepted that the agreement does exist. Chairman, as you said, there may be more accurate information to assuage our concerns. If you look at the practice and procedure, 3A, it is made very clear that to be fair and to be seen to be fair, we have to be fair and seem to be fair to parties whose interests or reputation may be affected. We're going to be inviting all these witnesses, including Mr. CY Leung.
Well, CY Leung seems to be aggrieved, of course, and he has actually sent some legal documents to our members. Well, it would be appropriate for him to be here so he can clarify all these issues. I just don't get it why we want to make things so abstract. I think the more abstract our work is, then it would be more difficult for CY Leung to prove his innocence. I don't think it will help the conduct of this meeting if we dwell on this point for too long. Mr. Kenneth Leung, did you raise your hand? No, I did not. I was listening to members. Mr. Alvin Young, Chairman, I agree with Mr. Andrew Wan that the proposed major areas of study is just a set of logic. This set of logic will help us narrow our scope. 1C is for fact-finding, and that is whether Mr. Leung provided any assistance as per the agreement. And Roman 3 is that after we have established the facts, whether any conflict of interest had been involved. That is another kind of fact-finding. And there are two sets of logic attending to those. Therefore, I agree with the way the appendix is formulated by the Secretariat so that we can zoom in to the issues we have to focus on. I don't think we need to change the appendix in any way. Actually, I can't see the difference in the terms of reference and also the areas of study. If you want to argue on the wording, let us have a lesson on Chinese. Well, I think apart from Mr. Holden Chow and Mr. Junius Ho, it seems other members don't object to having this proposed areas of study. Maybe as Ms. Priscilla Leung said, we can comb through the appendix and let us be careful about the wording. And then Ms. Yong has also said that she has some views about the order of the points. But then according to our convention, the Secretariat would always draw up such proposed major areas of study for us. And on that basis, would you object to following Ms. Priscilla Leung's proposal, and that is we go through the agreement point by point? As for 1C and the phrase, as per the terms of the UGL agreement, I think we have had a discussion on that, and now you understand why the Secretariat has done so. If there are no other major views, let us go to Roman 2. Yes, Mr. Holden Chow. Chairman, I heard Ms. Eunice Yong, and I think she made a good suggestion. Allow me to say this, because 1C, whether Mr. Leung had provided any service or assistance to UGL as per the terms of the UGL agreement after he had become the CE. And under 3, conflict of interest D, I think there is a repetition there. To simplify matters, 1A and B, the major terms and conditions of the agreement and the payments made, perhaps these can be moved to 3, and then you don't need 1C because you don't have to make a repetition. If we are just asking the same questions, there is no need to repeat whether Mr. Leung had provided any service or assistance as per the terms of the agreement after he had become the CE. We would ask those questions under conflict of interest. So we don't need to ask this question under background. To simplify things, we can ask Mr. Leung to explain the terms, the payments, and then we can follow the conflict of interest part. I think that would make things more simple. Thank you. The Secretariat, I don't think they have major views on this. I think that is feasible. As I hear from you, I think you're just moving the points around. Members, any major points or opposition to Mr. Holden Chow's view? I don't think there is any problem with reordering the points here, whether 1C is where it is or under 3. I don't think it's a big problem. Who should go first? Mr. Lam Chek Ting, because you raised your hand first. Chairman, thank you. I have no qualms about the order of the points. But 1C has to remain in essence, and that is whether CY Leung had provided any service or assistance to UGL as per the terms of the UGL agreement after he had become the CE. Well, yes, it will stay in essence. It is just the order of the points. Ms. Priscilla Leung, well, let me propose this. Perhaps the Secretariat can do this, 1C, as per the terms of the UGL agreement, because after all, we are going to look at the agreement and also the handwritten line. That is for sure. If some members think that this is unsettling for them, and if the points are to be reordered, then maybe the Secretariat can also think about adding one or two words. I'm just mentioning this in passing. No, if we accept the reordering of the points as proposed by Mr. Holden Chow and Ms. Eunice Yong, then there will be space for adding one or two words, and that would help us tidy up the matter. What do you mean? I can understand your point on the ordering of the different points, but now here it says whether service had been provided as per the terms of the UGL agreement. I don't have all the ideas now, but the controversy is whether it is as per the terms of the UGL agreement. As you know, we would certainly be looking at the agreement, but when we formulate the areas of study, perhaps when you write this, you can add a little to it to fine-tune it, then maybe other members would find that more acceptable. I don't exactly insist on this, but if we are going to reorder the points anyway, and if there is no opposition to the reordering of the points, then the Secretariat can go back and think about this, and then they have to come back for endorsement. Well, I'm not sure we need to endorse this again, because we should not be spending too much time on this. Well, never mind. The legal advisor and the Secretariat have already heard you, and they have heard whether one or two words should be added to 1C. Mr. Alvin Young, let us ask Ms. Priscilla Leung to point out exactly what revision she wants. No one can know what she has in mind without her telling us. This will add to the burden of the Secretariat, and that is quite unnecessary. If she wants any revision, say it in concrete terms so all members can comment on it. Don't let this sit there for half a month and another month, because Ms. Priscilla Leung may have other ideas down the road, and then she may have other ideas later on. Mr. Kenneth Leung, Chairman, a quick point. The appendix is an appendix. It is not the paper proper and doesn't have to be endorsed. This is just a kind of mental process. This is not the paper itself. It is an appendix. Chairman, please guide us to do this. It is just a mental process. This is not a paper. Chairman, this is the appendix. Well, the purpose of this select committee is that we have this collective mental process. Ms. Priscilla Leung, Mr. Alvin Young, you don't have to be so worked up. When select committees discuss major areas of study, this always happens. You can go back on previous information. I'm just thinking out loud now. Well, you can go back and think about it. If there can be any improvement, let's make it. And in principle, even if you cross out everything here, we can still ask the same questions. So strictly speaking, this is nothing major. Every member can still follow the appendix, and you can even ask more acute questions. Well, exactly. That is why we should not spend too much time on this. Let us not haggle over the fine wording of the appendix. This is not the TOR. Mr. Andrew Wen, a quick point. Chairman, the more we discuss this, the more confused we are. Well, look at the logic. There are three major points, and we are talking about the terms, the payments, and then there is now this accusation, whether this is appropriate, whether there is declaration or conflict of interest. We want to inquire into all these, and the answer may be in the negative. And I just can't figure this out. Why 1C is a problem? Now, if you cross out the phrases per the terms of the UGL agreement, then it would not be mutually inclusive as per our previous thinking, because it will lose its focus. We are talking about whether Mr. Leung had provided any service assistance. Without that parameter, it will be more dangerous and it will be easier for Mr. Leung to be caught. Exactly. I was saying we should use the UGL agreement as the framework, and whether it is in the first part or the third part of the appendix, it doesn't really matter. So if members have no other concrete points to make, let us not talk too much about this, because it would just delay the process of this meeting. It seems the major point is that we can continue in this direction. Maybe the legal advisor and the secretariat can revisit 1C to retain its position or to have it subsumed under 3. And between today and the next meeting, if you have more concrete views for revising the appendix, please, I welcome your views, and you can furnish them to the secretariat or the legal advisor. Mr. Holdenchow, unless you have a concrete point to make, I don't think we should drag on this point. No, I'm not dragging on anything. I'm just persisting that if we can move 1C to 3, okay, you are proposing to do this. All right. Thank you. Thank you for your suggestion. I've heard you. Well, this did not seem to be a very important issue, but then members spoke out nevertheless, so that goes to show that we are very serious about our work. Okay, so about the declaration part, under 2, any points to make? If not, item 3, conflict of interest. There was a suggestion to put 1C under 3. Apart from that, any other comments? Ms. Priscilla Leung. I'd like to go back to 2D, please. If so, whether Mr. Leung had complied with those requirements to declare his interest in receiving the payments upon assumption or during the term of the office of the chief executive. Is this necessary at all? I'm really raising this. Maybe members can freely ask these questions. You can see from 2ABC. Certainly, that should be within the scope of our inquiry. And then D should be left to members to ask questions if they want to. We don't need D. Well, actually, this is an important point for fact-finding purposes. Maybe I can listen to other members. Mr. Lam Chek Ting, you raised your hand first. Chairman, I really thank the Secretariat for the drafting, because they have acted on the basis of the TOR. This is in compliance with point 1 of the TOR, whether Mr. Leung had complied with the declaration requirements under Article 47 of the Basic Law on the System of Declaration of Interest by members of the Executive Council. I can't see how the proposed major areas of study have deviated from the TOR. They say the same thing. This is within the TOR. Is it, as Mr. Junius Ho is saying, that he can smell trouble? Well, let us not target members. Let us target the issue. Even if you say the same thing, it may mean differently if the forum is different. Mr. Andrew Wen, I object to Ms. Priscilla Leung's point, because D is in line with 1. This is really asking a very targeted question. And then number 3, if the answer is in the affirmative, then it would just have to stop there, and it would sound very strange. Well, maybe members want very high safety parameters, but I don't think it's necessary for us to drag on along these lines. Now, this is a benevolent suggestion. Perhaps we can phrase this as a question instead of a statement. Let us say, if so, whether Mr. Leung had declared the interest, so on and so forth. Maybe we can do something about the punctuation so we don't have to be dragged down by this. Well, yes, that's a good suggestion. Maybe we can use a question mark instead of a full stop. But I thank Mr. Legal Advisor, for making Mr. Lam Chek Ting's point, because in fact this is one very important point in our TOR. We're actually using the same wording.
Mr. Houghton Chow, Chairman, I noticed that Mrs. Karen Lam, the CS, made a reply in LegCo on the 29th of December 2014. I've read her reply, and it said, now we're talking about BL 47 regarding declaration of by the chief executive to the CJ, and the declaration is of a confidential nature. Of course, I appreciate that in 2D, it is an important question we'd like to find out more about, but my view is that under BL 47, there is a declaration by the CE to the CJ, and it is a confidential matter. I can't quite figure out how we should phrase it, but in these major areas of study, we have to make it clear. Under BL 47, if it is confidential in nature, I don't think we should investigate it here. For D, I appreciate that members would like to put a question here, but under BL 47, it is of confidential nature. I'm not sure whether we are safe in this regard. Well, confidentiality is about the details. We can deal with this behind closed doors. We are asking whether he has made a declaration. Just because it is confidential doesn't mean that we should shy away from putting a question in this regard. Mr. Kenneth Leung, BL 47 says that the chief executive has to make a declaration to the CJ, his assets. Mrs. Carrie Lam, the CS, interpreted BL 47, what it is a correct interpretation. I have my reservation. She was the topmost AO in Hong Kong at the time. Article 47 of the Basic Law doesn't refer to confidentiality. I think in the process of examination, Chairman or the legal advisor will be guiding us here. I think we can leave the consideration till then. Mr. Elfin Yeung, Chairman, I think Mr. Holden Chow referred to the confidentiality. I'd like to look at this from another perspective. 2D is about whether declaration has been made. We're not here to dwell on the content of the declaration. It is a mere fact finding whether Mr. Leung has made the declaration as per BL 47. It's not about what he declared at all. These are two totally different concepts. 2D remains at the first level, whether declaration has been made. All right, thank you very much. I think the points are getting repetitive now. Any supplement? Mr. Holden Chow, Chairman. I'd like to advance another viewpoint. I'm referring to Mrs. Carrie Lam's written reply, and she made it very clear that when he assumed office, the CE has to make a declaration to the CJ, his assets for record. The CE has to make such a declaration, and then she went on to say that the declaration was of a confidential nature. Chairman, you made the point about whether declaration has been made, and you also made the point about the content of the declaration. I think to be safe, whether he made the declaration to the CJ. Now the question is whether he declared the £4 million. Now, if you take Mr. Elvin Young's question, and the moment we started asking this question, then it would we would touch on the confidentiality. here we make it very specific about the £4 million, what he made a declaration. If you ask him what a declaration has been made, then we'll be touching on the content of the declaration to see, Mr. Chow, there is a question whether the payment should be declared. Now, if the answer is no, then question D will not exist. And we are fellow lawyers. Perhaps you might wish to have a look at C and see whether this is still your concern. Mr. Lam Chak Ting, Chairman. Mr. Holden Chow played up confidentiality, and this is making me worried. If we follow Mr. Chow's logic, we can scrap the TOR altogether because we are investigating, we're inquiring into the declaration by the CE at Exco, what he has done so under BL 47. You refer to confidentiality. Anything can be confidential, and we don't, we cannot proceed at all. I don't think we should be too pedantic. I think we have to apply our common sense and exercise our judgment here. These proposed major areas of study prepared by the Secretariat, is it good enough? It is reasonable. If it is, then we can proceed. If Mr. Leung, when coming here, feels that there is so much information that he wants to divulge in answer to the questions, then it is his business. We don't have to be worried about the confidentiality. We can deal with the issues when they come up. I think at this point in time, this is a just and fair select committee. I don't think we should raise doubts about the wordings chosen by the Secretariat. I'm sure the Secretariat has been really impartial. As lawyers, we may be more sensitive to the phraseology and the wordings if they're not really too detrimental. I don't think we should be disclosing our bottom line too much here. As regards the declaration, as Mr. Holden Chow said, the CS referred to the declaration and the confidentiality. I don't think we should be too conservative here in this regard and be overly concerned and worried. I appreciate your line of thought here. Other than Mr. Chow, any further comments regarding Roman letter 2? If not, then we move on very quickly to number 3, conflict of interest. Ms. Eunice Yong made the point about the sequence. And regarding 3, any comments, please? Mr. Chow? You're very vocal today. Yes, beg your pardon, Chairman. Maybe like you said, as a lawyer, I am rather too sensitive to the wordings. That's only right. B, if I may draw members' attention to that, to provide such assistance in the promotion of UGL Group and the DTZ Group, as UGL may reasonably require, including but not limited to acting as a referee and advisor from time to time. I pause here. Now, if you look at the English version, referee and advisor, to be more precise, I used. Now, referee and advisor may be open to interpretation. The Chinese version for referee and advisor may not accurately convey the meaning. A referee may involve a situation where they would ask you about the staff. It may not be making any reference or making any referral. It's just a general inquiry about the status or the attribute of a certain staff. So the Chinese version for referee and advisor may give rise to misunderstanding. I think advisor or referee may involve the role of being consulted. Referee and advisor here. Maybe the roles are more like consultative or advisory role. I think we can just say an advisor in the Chinese version. Well, there's a lot of pleading. I think we have to exercise our judgment. The Secretariat has heard what you have to say. Perhaps the Secretariat might wish to have a look at this. Mr. Lam Chuk Ting. Chairman, I'm grateful to Mr. Holden Chow for being so careful with every single word and every single sentence. If I may put a question to Mr. Chow here, I think we work on the basis of the English version. The English should prevail. Here he says, provide such assistance in the promotion of the UGL group and the DTZ group. I think it is made very clear this is to promote the company. So as a referee or as an advisor, it is your job to promote the company. To advise sounds more like a neutral role. It is not his role. It is his role to promote this listed company. So as a referee and as an advisor, I think the translation is absolutely accurate. I'm not sure how Mr. Chow feels about it. Before I call upon Ms. Alvin Young, the legal advisor and the secretary reminded me that even for the Chinese version, we can stick with the English version. If members are so concerned, this is one way to go. I was also reminded that in a handset, the English version has been translated, and there is a proper translation for these two terms. Members don't have to be worried too much about it, otherwise I will be inviting the translator here to offer an explanation. I don't think Mr. Chow would like to go that far, would he? Ms. Alvin Young, Chairman, thank you. I do admire Mr. Holden Chow for his sensitivity to the wordings. I think we can insert all the possible Chinese translation for a referee. We have all these words added there with a slash in between them. Thanks very much for your sense of humor, Mr. Young. Dr. Priscilla Leung, well, between 91 and 97, I've been sitting on the Committee on Translating Laws in Hong Kong. I mean, it is really unreadable in some cases. It's very difficult. I agree that you should add a parenthesis there in the Chinese version. It would be far more accurate in the Chinese contracts. There are some interns who need referees. In the course of our inquiry, the word referee may give rise to some other meanings and not so much a sponsor. I think if we can insert a parenthesis in the Chinese version for a referee, it would avoid all the unnecessary trouble. This is so much I have to say regarding this point. Chairman, should I go on to another point?
Is it about this part? We are now on part three. Do you want to deviate from part three and go to another area? That's correct. I like to make another comment. Now, are you hurrying or in a hurry to go? If not, let us stay with this term first. Well, for me, I think we should keep the English in a bracket in the Chinese version. This is not a pleading. This is not a final report of the Select Committee either. If you ask to put the English term in a bracket in the Chinese version, and if you have a lot of worries, maybe I can say you are over worried. But if you really want to do it and think that is an improvement, if the Secretariat doesn't mind, then perhaps we can further fine-tune the appendix so as to satisfy you. Mr. Holden Chow, do you still want some fine-tuning?
Well, yes, I still have a concern, please. My observation is that this is related to what Mr. Lam Chek Ting just said. I'm aware that the UGL agreement, as read out by Mr. Lam Chek Ting, that was amended, and the line provided that such assistance does not create any conflict of interest has been added to it. It is a handwritten line. In Chinese, it means no matter what assistance will be provided, it should absolutely not create any conflict of interest. This handwritten line is already evident in the agreement document we have in front of us. For the sake of authenticity, I'd like to propose this for your consideration. Under B, including but not limited to acting as a referee and advisor, perhaps we should also state, for the sake of clarity, that on the condition that such assistance does not create any conflict of interest. And indeed, this is what has been added to the agreement. And to reflect reality, perhaps we should add this line as well to B. But Mr. Holden Chow, C takes care exactly about this concern of yours. This is really tailored to meet your need. C says whether the term had been modified in any way, and if so, the effect of the term is modified. I think this provides even more clarity. This is, in a way, a footnote to let us find out whether the agreement has been modified in any way. If we repeat too much, I think that would be redundant. Since we have C, I don't think we need to add what you said to B, or else I don't know whether you would agree with me, because C can already qualify B. Chairman, I understand what you are saying, but allow me to say this. If this is what you are saying, let me mention that C says whether the term had been modified in any way. But please allow me to say this. The agreement that is before us is evident that it has been modified. So C should not ask whether the term had been modified in any way, because it has been modified, and the modification is as I read out, that provided that such assistance does not create any conflict of interest. So to me, you should not have the first leg. You should just state the term had been modified, instead of phrasing it as a question. Well, this is just a paper provided for our reference. We don't know whether this will be the final authentic copy. Of course, in our Hansard, Mr. CY Leung also answered questions to say that he himself added in the line, but then we have not really inquired into it as a select committee. And in fact, the select committee also has to decide whether the term had been modified, and if so, in any way. Therefore, we should not presume too much that indeed the agreement has been modified. Legal advisor,
Yes, you have taken words out of my mouth. And may I add to what you said, Chairman?
We have seen handwritten notes in the agreement, but whether there has been further correspondence to modify the agreement in any way, we don't know. So we have drafted this in an open manner, and we have no preconceived stance. Perhaps I can propose a compromise. If Mr. Holden Chow would like to mention the handwritten note, perhaps under C we can add the line, the handwritten line to C, but then it would not be limited to this, because if the modification is limited to the handwritten line, we just don't know. We haven't started our inquiry because there can be other modifications. Thank you, Mr. Kenneth Leung. I object to any change because Mr. Holden Chow has already gone into the substantiation process. We are not taking substantive evidence. We should not be discussing this because perhaps the agreement has not been modified. Who knows? This is just a working draft or a working paper. We want to have evidence to prove whether there is an authentic version that is acceptable to both parties. I think C is a very accurate description. Mr. Andrew Wan, I agree with Mr. Kenneth Leung, and I can give some examples to help Mr. Holden Chow. As you said, Chairman, this may be a paper for our reference, or it may not be such a paper. Secondly, even if we use this paper, and I'm talking about a second scenario, perhaps it has not been modified. Perhaps the agreement as presented to Mr. Leung could have included this handwritten line. And this is about the sequencing of matters. Whether it has been modified, we are talking about the time of signing the agreement, instead of whether this agreement has been modified. Even if the typewritten lines, that might have been the subject of modification. This is my wife's birthday today, and I'm declaring interest. Please, let us not go on like this. And I can give you one or two more possibilities, because if this is how we are discussing matters, it can be endless. Well, I will try to control and manage the time, and I won't allow you to disappoint your wife. Mr. Holden Chow.
I have heard the legal advisor. I tend to agree with the legal advisor's explanation. Number one, maybe you can question that there have been subsequent modifications. I can see where you come from. But I also want to point out that this modification does exist because we can see it. And also let me say this. I heard Mr. Kenneth Leung say perhaps there has not been any modification. And let me remind members, if you want to ask that kind of question and whether there is any matter of false documentation. Now, you know, I don't want to go into that at all because that can be very serious. For the sake of safety, since we see this, we can see this modification, as the legal advisor said, we should mention it. But as to whether there have been further correspondence, certainly we can explore into that. But we should clarify this. Otherwise, there can be misunderstanding. Well, I don't think Mr. Kenneth Leung is asking any questions about honesty or false documents. I think we are just dealing with a very common issue, and that is before the inquiry actually starts, we are still just preparing the framework. And we don't even know whether this is the paper to be used. We don't even know who has written this paper. And you can see the handwritten note, but is that what it is? And in fact, the other party has not signed the agreement. So should this be the document we are using? And also, as the legal advisor said, could there have been other oral or written correspondence, and whether there are other documents modifying this document? We haven't gone into that at all. So let us not be over worried about this. The legal advisor and the secretariat can make final arrangements. I don't think it's a big problem.
Mr. Kenneth Leung, have we answered your point? Just like to supplement, let us look at our TOR. It is for fact-finding. We do not have any criminal investigation power. I have no power to mention those matters. We should not use that kind of wording. Please, let us all stay alert to that. Thank you. If there are no other matters, Ms. Priscilla Leung, I think, wants to ask another question. I have already said that I would not allow Mr. Andrew Wen to disappoint his wife. Number four, taxation issues. Any concerns you'd like to raise? If not, apart from what we mentioned, that would be for the Secretariat and the Legal Advisor to tidy up. Let us say we have endorsed this paper. Ms. Priscilla Leung, a small point about 1C. I can think of one word in Chinese. Can we say an UGL agreement? Let us write the word. Let us put an article before UGL agreement, because that is what has been rumored. Well, we don't know. We don't know whether there has been one or more agreements. In the TOR, we have stated the agreement signed in 2011. We, of course, are pointing to one agreement. Maybe you have insider information that there is another agreement. No, I don't have any insider information. But people seem to be questioning whether this is the agreement. And it seems we are assuming this is the agreement. And it is said that this is circulated on the internet. That is why I'm making this proposal. Okay, that will be for the consideration of the Secretariat. It is not a strong view of mine. I'm just trying to tackle what members have been saying, that this is just a rumored agreement. Thank you, Mr. Andrew Wen. Chairman, my worry is that, of course, we all want to find the truth, but let us not tag too much to what we have decided upon, because if you write too much, it can create loopholes and give rise to different interpretations. Ms. Priscilla Leung may be well-intentioned, but as I heard her, this thought came to mind, and that is whether Ms. Leung knew about other agreements. And if you say one UGL agreement, which one are you talking about, or would you be deliberate in looking only into one agreement? So the more we say, the more confusing it will be. Don't be over worried. I don't know why you smell trouble. I think this is just fine. I think the Secretariat has done a fine job. You don't need to have very many safety parameters. Thank you very much, Mr. Wen. But before we leave this, I will just let members know that the Secretariat will also formulate the list for evidence to be taken and also the list of witnesses to be called. If you have any views, please let the Secretariat know or let me know. And also, this is just a working paper, and members can revise it any time. You can add things to it or remove anything from it. Please do understand that this is a flexible working paper, letting us know the directions or the framework. Mr. Junius Ho, yes, I will still want to go back to my previous point. I would move a motion that we do not make reference to this appendix. I think it is not binding. I don't want to read it. You were having this heated discussion on all the points. I was just not interested. I would just follow the TOR. Anything that distracts me will not bind me. This should be recorded. If you can allow me, I will move a motion to delete it altogether. It doesn't matter how you think about this, but I don't want to be bound by this. I understand your worry, but it seems the majority of our membership do think that this is a useful guide. Well, perhaps you should ask for a show of hands. Well, I won't object to having a vote taken if you think there is a big controversy, but if this is not a crucial point, if this is just a working paper, I don't think we need a vote. It might even put a barrier on our way.
Hey. 秘書處的同事都提提我呢，我哋點解咁？I
was just reminded that this paper will be posted on the web, so the members of the public would follow our work, and this is to facilitate our work here. If you want to put it to the vote, I would take your view, but if we don't need to have this put to the vote, I think it would certainly be more conducive to our work if we can just work things out among ourselves. If we have to put even this to the vote, there will be plenty of voting that will take place in future. At the PAC hearings, we bear in mind that we're working together. We don't have to state our stance because of our political stance. Mr. Kenneth Leung, Chairman, as Vice Chairman of the PAC, I 200% agree with what you had to say, because we are really working on this. We want to have the issues dealt with by consultation, by agreement. The less we put things to the vote, the better. We like to have everything done by consultation. Although I agree, I respect Mr. Junior's whole, the mental process would be important. Everybody would have different mental processes. This is not a formal paper per se. We're at liberty to use our mental process within the scope of our inquiry. Any further views? Mr. Ho? Do you still insist on putting this to the vote? I made this very clear. Everything is derived from the terms of reference. As I said a moment ago, I don't really want to be challenged in future because of this appendix. I think what happened just now bears witness to the fact that we can just proceed according to the TOR. Members do have diverse views regarding the appendix. I think we can just stick with the terms of reference without having to rely on the appendix and the proposed major areas of study. The TOR has given us the scope. Thanks very much for your insistence, Mr. Ho. We have spent quite a bit of time. And the consensus seems to be that this is only a guidance for us. If we overrule all the discussion, then we'll not be constructive. Let me put this to members. Do you see the need for a vote to be taken? Chairman, I'm not inclined towards a vote. We should have a consensus. Mr. Ho, I understand your insistence. If we proceed like this, we will not be able to get this done within a year. We will spend 4 years on this. Now, even if a question that members would like to put will be subject to a vote, I understand what you insist on, Chairman. I'm not insisting on this unnecessarily. This is a matter of principle. We have the TOR. It is there. We don't need anything else to assist us to understand the TOR. I think what we need to do is just to follow the three areas in the TOR. I don't really want to do anything unnecessary. I don't really want to make anything complicated. Simple is beauty. Appreciate that, Mr. Lam Chuk Ting, Chairman. I've been trying to exercise my maximum patience about an hour or so ago, Mr. Chairman. Having listened to members' views, I think you have made the summary, and Mr. Junizhou has already ventilated his views and nobly raised any contra views except Mr. Junizhou. But I don't think anybody objected to what you had to say before we moved into the proposed major areas of study. Now, we're done with the discussion. Mr. Junizhou came back and said that we could do away with these proposed areas of study. This is impinging on our progress. I didn't see the need for a vote. We've already had discussions on the appendix, and we basically have some sort of a consensus. Mr. Alden Chow, Dr. Priscilla Leung raised all these comments, and they have been dealt with already. I don't think it's a good idea to waste any more time. We're not being personal. We're just proceeding according to the way we wanted to proceed, and we want members to cooperate, to be cooperative, and to be understanding. Mr. Junizhou, do you still insist on a vote? Mr. Holden Chow, Chairman. In the past hour or so, I've been very, very vocal, and I've raised many suggestions. I'm grateful to the Secretariat for being so accommodating regarding my suggestions. If we go back to square one and put this to the vote, then what we have done over the past hour or so seems to be wasted. Mr. Junizhou expressed very strong views at the very beginning, and at the very beginning we did say that to minimize the disputes, I would just stick with the terms of reference. Mr. Ho is insisting on this. I think it is not a bad idea to let him have the chance to put this to the vote. Myself and Priscilla and other members have spent an hour or so here on this paper. I think if he insists on this, I think we can just have a vote. Mr. Wong, Chairman, I just popped to the toilet. I'm not sure what you're talking about. What vote are you talking about? Let me repeat. After an hour of discussion, Mr. Junizhou insisted that we do away with the proposed major areas of study. It seems Mr. Wong looked surprised. I understand members' views, and as I said, we'd like to be more consultative. I would like to do this by consultation. Once we've started this precedent, we may need to have more time for preparation for the hearings. Because once we have started, this may be repeated going forward. If I can't use my soft power to convince Mr. Ho and put this to the vote, then in future I can't be using any double standard, and there will be more votes to be taken in future, and this will be impinging on the progress of this committee is entirely up to members. Mr. Leung, well, I insist on not having any vote. You have, you can have the discretion, Chairman. Mr. Ho, I am saying that we should stick with the TOR. TOR is TOR. We should not be building on the TOR. I think you should for the record, this is not an extension of the terms of reference. It's up to you how you use your mental process in future. As I said, this is not a part of the terms of reference. Nobody's saying that this is part of the terms of reference. I'd like to go on record to say that the TOR has included these proposed major areas of study. And I've made it very clear that this is not part of the TOR. I think this is really unauthorized adjunct to the TOR. From my point of view, this is an unauthorized adjunct. It is indeed an authorized adjunct. Whether they are similar, it's quite another matter altogether, but these are not the exact same wordings, and this is not an authentic version of the terms of reference. This is a legal point that I'm making. When it comes to legal proceedings, I'm sure we have a lot of comments regarding how we should phrase the writ. Now, we're not debating the terms of reference. We are just discussing the proposed major areas of work of study produced by the Secretariat to facilitate our work. Of course, we do have the right to go back to the full council to discuss the TOR, but we're not dealing with the TOR. I don't think that there should be any misunderstanding. Mr. Alvin Young, Chairman. Mr. Junius Ho is alleging that this is an unauthorized adjunct. And this is a tremendous allegation. This is not fair to the Secretariat. Previously, in previous select committees, did we have any way to deal with it? In previous select committees, did members accept that in addition to the TOR, we had the proposed major areas of study? If that was the convention, I hope that the Secretariat would get the record straight. I think the Secretariat has already answered that, but please try again. Indeed, Chairman, in the past seven select committees, we had the TOR, and on the basis of the TOR, we drafted proposed major areas of study. That's more like a context, a framework for members to proceed with the inquiry. All right, let me do this. Now, this is a collective decision. Do we need to put this to the vote on the basis of Mr. Strindis Ho's suggestion? And I think we can just gauge our members' views. We just have a show of our stance. Dr. Priscilla Leung, I appreciate Mr. Junius Ho's sentiment, and maybe you want to have a clear record. I fully understand that he has made this very clear. I also understand that the Secretariat has produced these proposed major areas of study, and members will be raising questions in these different areas, and they are not part of the terms of reference. So this is my view all along. Chairman, would it be a good idea for 5 minutes to be given for us to discuss this? Now, I know that we have been spending an hour or so on this. If a member is insisting on this, I think we have to respect this, even if this is in the minority. Perhaps we should have the indulgence of 5 minutes to work it out. We may not be able to come to any conclusion the way we proceed here. So, Chairman, can we have 5 minutes? Mr. Chow, yes, let's take a break for 5 minutes for us to mull over this. All right, let's take a break. I still remember that Mr. Andrew Wan is getting across the message that we should not let his wife getting disappointed. All right, let's come back at 6:25. 6:20.